Welcome to the final session of this module 4. In the previous session we have discussed the tidal energy and the types of tidal energies and the problems associated with that and few of the advantages and disadvantages which is related to the tidal energy. Now let us study the one more type of tidal energy, that is a wave energy. Basically, wave and tides have got a lot of difference. People think it is the same thing. The tides are the one which comes with certain velocity because of the potential difference. Whereas the wave power is produced by the up and down motion of the floating devices. Maybe you might have seen it. If you keep any plastic or a light material or a wood onto them, moving, whether it may be a river or it may be ocean, if you put onto that, it always moves up and down according to the waves formation. And this wave formation may be due to the different reasons. I just will explain you. So this wave power, this is the only the up and down movement of this itself can be converted into electrical energy. That is one of the most interesting thing. Maybe I agree the efficiency of this wave energy conversion or harnessing this wave energy is less, but still it is possible. That is what we just try to prove it over here. In other words, wind produces waves, that is what, and then waves produce the energy. The wind energy, as I was just talking about the wind energy, the uneven surface heatings, the wind or the cyclones which causes over there, as they move, they also causes the waves to be formed. As the waves travel across the ocean, high-tech devices capture the natural movement of the ocean current and flow of swells to generate the power. Okay, then we can say that a wave energy is an indirect form of wind energy that causes the movement of the water. Basically, if I'm not wrong, the solar energy which will causes the wave energy, the solar energies will cause the wind energy to happen, and this wind energy will makes the wave energy to form. So that is the reason why it is also referred as an indirect way of solar energy or wind energy that causes the movement of this water on the surface of the ocean. By capturing this energy, the motion of the waves is converted into mechanical energy and caused to drive an electric generator which generates electricity. Now if this ocean's waves are generated by wind passing over the long stretches of water known as stretches. Now I was talking, maybe any place of the depression in the air, the pressure differences makes the wind to follow from the deep ocean, these from the deepest, from the farthest place of the earth or the land. So as it just keeps moving, on the surface of the water in the oceans, makes it to a longer stretches, which are called as fetches. These fetches makes the a part of the wind energy will be converted into the wave energy. That is the way this up and down movement of the waves does cause. Three main purposes are involved. The air flowing over the sea exerts a tangential stresses. Tangential stresses are nothing but like this. If it is like this, if this is the surface, the tangential forces will be always acting like this. You can see my finger on the pen. These are nothing but the tangential forces. If there is a water, you just imagine my hand has got a water. The tangential forces will always act like this. So, like this. Makes this wave to move up and downwards. Now even you can take the water in a bowl and if you pop the air, so what happened there exerts a minor waves formation. So the similarly in the large water content or the ocean, so what happens, there will be a huge formations of the waves. And maybe the second reason is the second purpose of this generation, the fetches, is due to the turbulent air close to the water surface creates rapidly varying shear stresses. Shear stresses is nothing but one force which acts like this and another force which acts like this. So they are acting like this. So this is what we call it as the shear force. These shear forces will act. Okay, these shear forces will act on the surface of the water, which creates a shear stresses and then pressure fluctuations, where these oscillations are in phase with existing waves. Further waves development occurs. Finally, when waves have reached a certain size, the wind can exert a stronger force on the upwind face of the wave, causing the additional wave growth. It's very simple. If you check this, so what happens? One is because of the tangential stresses are acting on that, and then because of the shear forces, there will be a shear stress and the pressure fluctuations making the water to lift. So that what happens, the water, a slight formation of the wave will be there, and further air which is blowing against to that, what it will do, it is, it acts at the upwind face of this. If the wind is like this, it exerts like this and makes this wave to move further upwards, causing additional wave growth. That is the physics behind of it. Then you can see this, once this up and down movements have been placed, now in this case you can see a strong dark blue lines. This is called as a wavy, something like a sinusoidal movement. So this height and depth is being utilized, whereas in case of a tidal energy, the velocity with which it is moving or the height or the potential energy is being utilized, whereas here the height, the up and down movement is being used. Please be careful, wave and tidal, they are similar but entirely different in harnessing it. Is it clear? Since both have been generating in the ocean, they appears to be same but not at all same. Tides, wherein which the potential energy is being used, and these tides are being used or formed because of the gravitational force of sun, moon with the earth, where 70% of the gravitational force of the moon is influenced on this. Whereas waves are formed because of the movement of the air which causes the wave, which is where this up and down movement is being utilized. This measures of wave power is used because the nature of the waves makes it impossible to refer to power per unit area. We have to consider that the wave action takes place throughout the depth of water, and so we consider the power passing through a 1 meter wide slice of water. Now you can see this wave, which is nothing but a surge which is coming over here. There is a submerged heavy ballast plate with the mooring line. There will be an anchor. Now at the bottom, as you can see this, there are two anchors which have been placed here. Anchors are used to restrict the movement of the ships also. So it is a heavy anchor like shape like this. It is something like this. Okay. They have been placed at the bottommost portion so that it will not go away because of the tides or the waves. Now as you can see it here, there are two buoyancy, the floating bodies will be there. They are heavy in weight. So that what happens, this has a pump and a generator will be there. Now this, what is this pump is? This pump is free to move up and downwards. Now please be careful here. These buoys or the floating bodies, whenever there is an upward movement, it moves upwards. Whenever there is a down in the wave, it comes like. So that what happens, continuously it moves up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. So apart from wind energy, where the rotational force is being utilized for conversion, whereas here the reciprocating motion. So it moves up at the up waves and it moves down because of the wave. When the wave rises, when the wave falls, wave rises, wave falls. So this makes the pump to have a reciprocating motion. This reciprocating motion will makes this reciprocating motion is nothing but a mechanical energy. This mechanical energy is being utilized for converting it into electrical energy. That is the major idea. So if we will have a linear absorber, hydraulic ram joints will be there, wherein which these movements in parallel will be taken for the usage. And we will have a generator over here, and it generates electricity and it will be transmitted. Now this tidal characteristics. Tides are single waves that stretch across the ocean basins. They are also shallow water waves because their wavelengths greatly exceed the depth of the ocean. They occur due to complex interactions of the moon and sun. A tidal power or a tidal energy is a form of hydropower that converts the energy obtained from the tides into useful form of power, mainly electricity. Although not yet widely used, tidal energy has potential for future electricity. Now, this tidal means tide energy as well as the wave energy. In both combination, we are just discussing about this. Both the wave energy and tide energy come under the same category, as they are not more efficient, but still, in future, there is a possibility, as I just told you. We just wanted to know that there is a possibility of using this. Okay. Advantage is it is also cheap energy source. After the initial investment is paid off, the cost of generating electricity is very low. Tidal energy has a high energy density, meaning that the tides store a large amount of energy than most of other forms of renewable energy sources, because it is continuous. All the 365 days it remains same thing. That is what we just meant to say. The disadvantages of tidal power: tidal power is growing rapidly in interest as countries look for ways to generate electricity without relying on the fossil fuels. Tidal schemes have a number of advantages, including their lack of greenhouse gas emissions and 100% renewable nature. That's okay. Tidal power is also relatively prosperous at low speeds. In contrast to wind power, water has 1000 times higher density than air. It is there because that is 1000 and this is 1 kg per meter cube. And tidal turbines can generate electricity at a speed as low as 1 meter per second or 2.2 meters per hour. My dear friends, this is the major things that you can remember. Where when we were talking about the wind energy, we spoke about the minimum speed which is required is 2 meters per second or 8 kilometers per hour is minimum required. Whereas here, even at 2.2 miles per hour, it can generate. Okay. What are the limitations of tidal energy? Intermittent tidal energy can only be produced electricity during tidal surges, limiting electricity generation to 10 hours per day. Expensive technology for generating electricity from tidal energy is relatively low, is relatively new and not yet commercially profitable. That is true, it is not at all. And my dear friends, even the materials that has to be used in the tidal energy should be very sophisticated, because they have to overcome all the odds of the sea water as well as heavy winds. It has to come across with the oxide or corrosion resistance for the saline or marine water. Is it there? Sustainable to certain locations. The biggest disadvantage to getting your energy from the waves is in locations. Effect on marine ecosystem: sources of disturbance for private and commercial vessels. Wavelengths matters a lot. Weak performance in rough weather. Noise and visual pollution. And the cost of production is very low. They are the one thing. And now let me come to this very interesting one. This is also from the ocean only. Now this is the third energy that we are talking about, the ocean thermal energy conversion system. That is popularly we remember it as OTEC. So my dear friends, this OTEC or ocean thermal energy conversion system generates electricity indirectly from solar energy by harnessing the temperature difference between sun warmed surface of tropical oceans and the colder deep waters. Now what happens is, interesting thing is, the solar radiations which are falling onto this earth is the same as the solar radiations which are falling onto the water also. But water or sea or ocean, it is in a liquid state, so it heats more. From morning 6 to evening 6, the surface will be heated more. Unfortunately, what happened, fortunately or unfortunately, the depth of the sea is so much that at the deepest point of the oceans, even the light will not penetrate. One thing, my dear friends, in the world, on the surface of the earth, the deepest point of the sea is 15 kilometers. The depth, it is 15 kilometers. You just imagine how deeper it will be. That is the reason why even the solar radiations doesn't penetrate to the depth. When they are not penetrating to the depth of the water or the sea, obviously the water will not be exposed to solar radiations, so it will be cold. The water on the surface will be exposed to sun, so it will be hotter. So this temperature difference is being utilized in order to generate electricity. A significant fraction of solar radiation incident on the ocean is retained by sea water in tropical regions, resulting in average year around the surface temperature of about 283. Okay, now the deep cold water meanwhile forms at higher latitudes and descends to so along the seashore towards the equator. The warm surface layer, which extends to depths of about 100 to 200 meters, is separated from the deep cold water by a thermocline. I just shall show you. The temperature difference T between the surface and the thousands meters depth ranges from 10 degrees centigrade to 253 degrees centigrade. Now actually with the larger difference occurring in equatorial and tropical waters. Okay, the temperature establishes the limits of the performance of OTEC power cycles. The rule of thumb is that the differential of about 203 degree Kelvin, I think is my difference, is necessary to sustain viable operations of the OTEC. I am extremely sorry, this is supposed to be 203 degree Kelvin, not degree centigrade, because the water boiling temperature itself is 100 degree centigrade. This cannot be degree centigrade. It has to be a degree Kelvin is necessary. Since the OTC exploits renewable solar energy, recurring costs of the generated electrical power are minimal. However, the fixed or capital cost of OTC systems per kilowatt of generating capacity are very high because the large pipelines and heat exchangers are needed to produce relatively modest amounts of electricity. These high fixed costs dominate the economics of OTEC to the extent that it cannot compete with conventional power energy sources, except in limited markets. Considerable effort has been expended over the past two decades to develop OTEC byproducts such as the fresh water, air conditioning system, mariculture, that offsets. So these are all the other applications. We can produce the fresh water, all those things. Now there are two different types of ocean thermal conversion systems are there. One is the open system and the other one is a closed system. Closed system are also called as a Rankine cycle, and it is also called as a Arsenal's original concept, which have been employed. A pure working is that could evaporate at a temperature of warm sea water. The working medium, what we are using it is a low boiling refrigerant. The vapor would subsequently expand and do work before being condensed by the cold sea water. I just shall show you. Okay. This series of steps would be repeated continuously with the same working whose soap path and the thermodynamic process representations constitutes closed loops, hence the name is called as a closed cycle. That means the working fluid keeps working closely and it keeps moving cyclic and it doesn't make an entry. So that is why we call it as a closed loop or a closed cycle. The specific purpose adopted for a closed cycle of OTC is a Rankine or vapor power cycle, which basically works on the principle of Rankine cycle. A simplified schematic diagram of it is been shown in the next slide. The principal component are the heat exchangers, turbo generators and the sea water supply systems, which although not shown accounts for some most of the parasitic power consumption and a significant fraction of the capital expense. Also not included are as auxiliary devices such as the separators to remove the residual liquid downstream of the evaporator and subsystems to hold and supply working is lost through the leaks or the contaminations. Now let me explain this, then I'll go back to this. We will have a warm sea water which is been taking away, which is been taking away the coldness, and it becomes a warm, whereas this whatever the coldness it has been there, it will be heated by the use of the warm sea water, and this vapor state of the refrigerant is coming and it is making the turbo generators to rotate on the turbines, which makes the turbines to rotate. A part of the energy will be lost over here. Thus a condensed the lost energy, with the lost energy the fluid will be coming to the condenser. This condenser will condenses it by the use of cold sea water which is coming over here and takes away the heat which is present in this liquid and becomes a warm discharge. So once it has been condensed, the liquid, the fluid will come into the pumps, and this once again the pump will pressurize the fluid. With the higher pressure it will be sent to the evaporator. So in the system, this is what in the system, the heat transfer from the warm surface of the sea water occurs in the evaporator, producing a saturated vapor from the working fluid. Electricity is generated when this gas expands at lower pressure through the turbine. Latent heat is being transferred from the vapor to the cold sea water in the condenser and resulting in a liquid pressurized with pump to repeat the cycle. Latent heat is being transferred. Okay, the success of the working Rankine cycle is a consequence of more energy being recovered when the vapor expands through the turbine than is consumed in repressurized liquid. In conventional example, in the combustion, the Rankine systems, this yields net electrical power. For ocean thermal energy conversion system, however, the remaining balance may be reduced sustainably by an amount of needed to the pump large volumes of seawater through the heat exchangers. Now actually, the OT, misconception about OTEC is that the tremendous energy must be expanded to bring the cold sea water up from depths approaching 1000 meters. In reality, the natural hydrostatic pressure gradient provides for most of the increase in the gravitational potential energy of the fluid particles moving with the gradient of the ocean depths to the surfaces. This is what. Now, if I talk about the open cycle, in the open cycle, I'll show you this open cycle, then I'll go for the explanations. Now here, the warm sea water is being deaerated over here. This is a deaeration, which is an optional one, wherein which the dissolved gases or the air will be removed using this deaeration, and this is required when the fresh liquid is entertaining every time. The vacuum chamber flash evaporator, wherein which the warm sea water discharges over here. The hot or the warm water above the surface of the ocean, which is making over here, and it is being discharged over here. The desalinated water vapor the desalinated water vapor comes and makes the turbine blades to rotate, and then it will go to the condenser where the part of its latent heat will be given away to the cold sea water. So this condensed liquid will be sent to the non-condensable gases, will also be released, and this desalinated water is being used for other purposes, which can be used as a healthy drinking water because it is being desalinated. So where here every time the liquid, the working fluid is changing, the working fluid is been changing, so only it is called as an open cycle. So if you see this open cycle ocean thermal energy conversion system, also called as a CLOTS concern, where this CLOTS concern about the most cost and potential biofouling of a closed cycle heat exchangers, led him to propose using steam generators directly from the warm seawater as the ocean thermal energy conversion working fluid. The steps for the CLOD or open cycle are the sash evaporation of warm sea water in a partial vacuum, and the second one is expansion of the steam through the turbine to generate the power, and then the condensation of vapor by direct contact heat exchanger to cold sea water. Compression and discharge of the condensate and any residual or non-condensable gases are also being removed. Unless the fresh water is a desired byproduct, open cycle OTEC eliminates the need for surface heat exchangers. Now, my dear friend, the major purpose of this open cycle is not to generate electricity, but it is to desalinate the water. That means filtering the dissolved salts in the sea water and making it worth for drinking. The name open cycle comes from the fact that the working fluid is discharged after a single pass and has a differential initial and final thermodynamic states. Hence the so path of the process are open. The entire system from evaporator to the condenser operates at partial vacuum, typically at pressures of 1 is of 3% of atmospheric. So 3% atmospheric, it is more. Initial evacuation of the system and removal of non-condensable gases during the operations are performed by vacuum compressors, which along with the sea water and discharges the pumps accounts for the bulk of the open cycle OTEC parasitic power consumption. The low system pressures of open cycle OTEC are necessary to induce boiling of the warm sea water. Flash evaporation is accomplished by exposing the sea water to pressures below the saturation pressure corresponding to its temperature. This is usually accomplished by pumping it into the evacuated chamber through the spouts designed to maximize the heat and mass transfer of the surface area. Removal of gases dissolved in seawater, which will come out of solution in the low pressure evaporator and compromise the operation, may be performed at an intermediate pressure prior to evaporation. Vapor produced in the sash evaporator is a relatively pure system. The heat of vaporization is extracted from the liquid phase, lowering its temperature and preventing any further boilings. Flash evaporation may be perceived then as a transfer of thermal energy from the bulk of the warm sea water of fraction of the mass that is being vaporized. Usually it is less than 0.5% of the mass of warm sea water entering the evaporator is converted into steam. The major problems associated with ocean thermal energy conversion systems. Some of the major drawbacks of the OTEC includes the following: construction of OTEC plants, and pipes in ocean may cause damage to onshore marine ecosystems and reefs. As this technology has been tested only in small scale, it is not feasible for an energy company to invest in this project. The main impacts associated with OTEC technologies are deep water discharges that can modify the trophic network. These can change the quantity and size of the species that are distributed in the areas surrounding the facilities of the plant. And visitors, seaside dwellers often find that their home is in high demand for the holidays of the others. So it is only because it is disturbing the visitors also. Sand, and everywhere more sand will be there. This is what the major problem with the any type of, not only OTEC, whether it is a wave energy or it may be tidal energy. So this is what the major problem. Salt and sea breezes certainly affect. Repair and insurances or maintenance is very difficult. Extreme weather, coastal erosions, rising the sea levels are entirely a major problems concerned to this OTEC. Thus ends the fourth module. And when we go to the fifth module, we shall discuss much more different types of ocean thermal, non-conventional energy sources.